You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hello and welcome back to Physics 195, Introduction to Planetary Science and Astronomy here at California State University, Dominguez Hills. I'm Bruce Betts of the Planetary Society. Today we're going to finish off talking about the Saturnian system and then move into the Uranian and Neptunian systems. But to start the class off, we've got a great guest from JPL, the Jet Propulsion Laboratory. We have the Deputy Project Scientist for Cassini, Scott Edgington. And remember, most everything we looked at in the Saturnian system last week, as well as when we talk more about Triton in a few minutes, comes from Cassini observations. It's been in orbit for about 10 years and still doing amazing things. Has revolutionized our understanding of all aspects of the Saturnian system. With that, let's go to Scott Edgington, and welcome. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you, Bruce. Thank you for inviting me.
And so, go ahead.
So Cassini is a mission that was launched in 1997. We arrived at Saturn in 2004, and we're coming up on our 10th anniversary this June, June 30th to be exact. And the spacecraft's about the size of a school bus. It has 12 instruments that we have visible cameras, we have infrared cameras, we have radio detectors, we have instruments that measure electrons, protons, neutrons. We address five science disciplines, and these include studying the planet itself, the rings of Saturn. We also study the magnetic bubble surrounding Saturn, and we're also interested in those moons orbiting Saturn, in particular Triton and Enceladus, and all the little ring moons that we have observed.
And you actually did fly a kitchen sink, is my impression. No, that's my stupid joke. Cassini's amazing because it has such a breadth of instrumentation, and you do such diverse science with it. I wonder if you could tell us about some of the, I know, more recent discoveries in that 10-year period, as well as any others that you want to mention. I know there's been a big announcement last week about Enceladus, but take it in whatever order you'd like. And I'm sorry, let me mention, when Scott talks about Enceladus, if the control room can pull up my first image and put it up, that would be great. If not, that's fine too. Go ahead.
Well, Enceladus, every once in a while we fly by Enceladus. When we're in the equatorial plane, we have the opportunity to visit it several times. And so over the course of the mission, there have been several visits of this moon, and a number of the orbits assigned to Enceladus was to look at the radio signal. And as you fly by this moon, the radio signal is Doppler shifted. And the Doppler shift is due to gravity, the gravitational pull of that moon. And so if you take a detailed look at that Doppler shift, you could tell what the gravity of Enceladus is. So one of the results, which came out last week,
and we do have the diagram up on the screen now. Go ahead.
Yes, I see the Dione Ocean. Yes. So one of the results is the discovery of a Dione Ocean. You can see at the South Pole.
Just to clarify, Enceladus, not Dione.
I'm sorry.
No problem. Just don't want to start new rumors.
Yes, Enceladus. Yes. So Enceladus, we had known that there were these plumes of water ice coming from the South Pole. And so we were very interested in flying by over the South Pole and measuring the gravity. And from the gravity, scientists have inferred that you need something other than water ice, a full water ice shell, and a rocky core. You need something in between, namely a liquid water layer. And this liquid water layer is about 30 kilometers deep under the shell and about 6 kilometers in width. So we think that that is covering most of the South Pole. It's still an open question as to whether it encompasses the whole of Enceladus, and that's left for other flybys to determine.
And so do you have, and you do have more flybys lined up in the future of Cassini?
Yes, there are three more flybys of Enceladus, one of which will take us right through those plumes, and we can measure the content of that water ice. Basically, what is it made of? How many water molecules can we detect coming from that region? So it's going to be an exciting flyby as we get really close and fly through that plume.
No, that's great. That's great. I know you're working a lot of different pieces of science at Cassini. Anything else in recent months that particularly intrigues you? Or?
Well, just this week, and the press release should be coming out soon. I know the publication has come out in the journal. The discovery of this new moon that's being formed in Saturn's rings. What we see with Cassini data is at the edge of the very edge of the rings is this clump of material, and this clump of material is caused by the gravitational pull of an object which is roughly 3 soccer fields in length, drawing in all of this material towards it, causing it to conglomerate into a moon. And we're thinking that we're seeing the birth of a new moon here.
Wow.
So that's hot off the press.
Yeah.
Yesterday, we just had our 101st Titan flyby.
Jeez.
And with this flyby, the emphasis was to literally sniff the atmosphere, basically determine what is the makeup of the atmosphere, what chemicals can we see in the atmosphere. So that was exciting, and we're still downlinking the data, so who knows what they'll discover in this latest batch of data.
Got a question from one of our students, Katie Gilliam. How long was Cassini originally built to last?
Well, our prime mission was 4 years, so after we got to Saturn in 2004, our warranty was to last till 2008. We have been going strong ever since, and we hope to keep on going for another 3 years. At the end of this 3 years, we have an end of mission planned. This is where we will literally be out of fuel, and we're going to use our last Titan flyby to take us from outside of the rings. All of our orbits so far have been inside of the ring or outside of the rings of Saturn. This last Titan orbit, 3 years from now, will allow us to jump from outside to inside the rings. And we will literally fly 22 times between the atmosphere of the planet and the rings of Saturn.
Wow.
There's a gap of about 2,000 kilometers there, which we think is clear. And we hope to get some exciting science from those orbits.
Wow. All sounds very exciting, and I know you've got lots more satellite flybys in the coming years and ongoing observations of the planet and the rings and the magnetosphere, so we will continue to look for much, much more.
Yes, and we have a video. It's a great promo video of the next 3 years. It's about 4 minutes long, so please go to our website, check it out, and you could see some of the exciting things that we're going to be doing in the next 3 years.
Let's see, I've got queued up Cassini coming attractions at Saturn. Is that the video or is there a newer one as well?
Yes, coming attractions, yes.
All right, we'll run that in a few minutes, perhaps after I talk Titan and get a better look at what you're doing. Thank you so much for joining us today. I know you got a really busy schedule going on, so we appreciate it.
Well, thank you for inviting me, and thank you for your support.
Oh, we love Cassini. Amazing mission.
Awesome.
Good luck. Keep going, and we'll talk to you later. Thanks so much.
Okay, thank you.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Okay, sorry, I turn around and I see some more questions, so. Okay, and unfortunately I have no idea to answer the first one. Caleb Lindquist, how much fuel does the craft burn up per day, month, or year? And then, let's see, we'll look at another one from Christopher Kane. Reminds me of Opportunity rover on Mars, you know, lasting way past the warranty. Yeah, and it's a great thing about NASA spacecraft, at least in recent decades. If they get where they're going, they usually last a really long time. if they fail, it's usually between launch and reaching their destination. Beyond that, they've done really, really well. So let's talk Titan. And then after Titan, we will take a look at the video that Scott referred to, Scott Edgington, and the coming attractions for Saturn. But first, let's talk about Saturn's largest moon, and until we discovered the craziness going on at Enceladus, by far the most intriguing moon, now competing for that title with Enceladus, but still quite fascinating. Let's go ahead and pull up, go ahead and pull up the first image that we were showing when Scott was on the Skype line, and go full screen. I'll just make sure I point out what's going on. So this is an artist's conception of Enceladus. Now remember, the weird thing about Enceladus having all this going on is it's not that big, and it's a big moon, but it's about 500 kilometers across, which is small compared to, say, the Galilean satellites of Jupiter, small compared to Titan that we'll be talking about in a few minutes. And what appears to be going on is some type of rock ice core, and then, of course, an ice shell. It's very water ice rich around the outside. But based upon their gravity data, they think they infer between this ice layer and this rock layer, liquid water. And yes, I have to say it, liquid water required by all life on Earth. And again, like with Europa, it's intriguing because we've got it next to a rocky surface, not just wedged between the ice. Now, there'll be more observations, try to confirm this, see if this ocean goes all the way around or not. I think you said 30 kilometers deep. And the concept is that in the South Polar region, you have fissures, cracks that eventually water comes out of and creates these geyser plumes that were the one of the surprise finds of the Cassini mission. Next image, and we'll start talking Titan. So here's just a pretty view of Titan in the foreground, rings, ring shadows, big Saturn planet. Next image. So this is what Voyager saw when Voyager 1 and 2 flew by Saturn. This is what Titan looked like. That's right, an orange featureless ball. That's what it looks like in visible wavelengths, and it makes Venus look exciting at visible wavelengths. Completely hazy, cloudy. Now, first of all, let us take a moment to appreciate, here's a moon with a really thick atmosphere. And it's the only place you find this in the solar system. You find moons with thin atmospheres, but not a really thick atmosphere. We've got a nitrogen atmosphere, so note, nitrogen, same main constituent as the Earth's atmosphere. There are three places in the solar system that have nitrogen as the main constituent. We'll talk about the third one when we get to Neptune. But in terms of thick atmospheres, it's Earth and Titan. As I mentioned last week, Titan, about 1.5 times the surface pressure of Earth, the atmospheric surface pressure. But because it's smaller, significantly smaller than Earth, has much lower gravity field, it actually allows the atmosphere to expand farther outwards. It's not being pulled down as much. And so you actually have an atmosphere that's about 6 to 7 times thicker than the Earth's atmosphere. So a very thick atmosphere. As I think I mentioned last week, originally, we thought Titan was the biggest atmosphere in, the biggest planet, moon, there we go, moon in the solar system, because the original telescopic observations were not distinguishing the atmosphere part. So with the atmosphere, it is bigger than Ganymede, but in terms of the surface, it is not. Now, we wanted to see more of this lovely beauty when we came back with Cassini. So they built in plans, as you might have already guessed, just like with Venus, radar forming a key aspect of this study, but also, like Venus and Venus Express, they found some near-infrared bands that are able to look through to the surface as well. And as Cassini has amazingly done 101 flybys as of yesterday of Titan. Titan being, besides Saturn, I mean, in terms of moons, the main focus of the orbital plans, because it is so large, so intriguing, has this thick atmosphere. I should mention, the thick atmosphere is basically hazy, cloudy with hydrocarbons. So very much like a very smoggy day on Earth, but it's they're not actually cars on the surface. We're sure of that. So a smoggy day, but lots of methane, ethane, that will become important and fascinating in just a moment. First, let's peer through with one of the early global images from the near-infrared of Titan. Let's go ahead and put the next image full screen. So now we've opened a window into the world of the surface of Titan, and right off the bat, without any geological assessment, you just go, hey, this is not just a featureless ball like the atmosphere at visible wavelengths. You got dark regions, you got light regions. Yes, those are technical terms, dark regions, light regions. And there's stuff going on. It's like looking all interesting and complicated. Well, it is. One of the other parts of the Cassini mission was the Huygens probe. So Cassini actually consisted of two components when it went to Saturn. It had the school bus sized, which is very large for a planetary spacecraft, school bus sized spacecraft orbiter, what went into orbit, still orbiting, still doing all this analysis. And then it carried an atmospheric probe called Huygens, named after the astronomer Christian Huygens. And that was actually built by the European Space Agency. Cassini-Huygens was a NASA-ESA collaboration. And when they got to the Saturn system, they got to Titan in 2004, they released the Huygens probe, and it went and deployed parachutes and floated through the very, very thick atmosphere in a much lower gravitational field. I believe it took 2 to 2.5 hours to float through the atmosphere, taking data all the way down, learning more about the atmosphere, what it's made of, its layering, etc. And though it wasn't technically a lander, they made sure it had a chance, at least some chance of surviving when it reached the surface. But on the way down, it took imagery. First, let's look at an artistic concept of such things. Let's look at the next image full screen. So this was from an art contest the Planetary Society did in collaboration with ESA, European Space Agency. So this is the concept. This was the Huygens probe under parachute, had lights when it got near the surface to illuminate things. Probably a little fanciful that you could actually see Saturn through all the haze by the time you reached the surface, and notice ponderings of liquid, which it did not see, but it saw evidence of past liquid, and liquid is where Titan gets really interesting. Let's look at the next image, and this is a mosaic of Huygens images as it's coming down through the lower parts of the atmosphere, and by golly gosh, look at what we see. We see dendritic patterns that look like where you have rainfall on Earth with streams that flow into rivers that flow down to a sea or an ocean. Now, we don't think we're looking at liquid actually right here, but we see evidence that other evidence has now corroborated the concept that you may actually get rainfall. That you actually carve these dendritic channels, flow into lake-type regions. Amazing. Now, what is that liquid? Well, let's look at the next image, full screen. This is the one image, because it didn't have a camera that was designed to turn, so the one image from the surface of Titan. And this is from the Huygens probe, of course. And these rocks, well, that's what happens to water on Titan. It becomes ice. Ice that's so hard, it basically acts like rocks on Earth. So it's not water ice. Let's look at the next image, because often you get a perspective that makes it seem like these rocks are bigger than they actually are. These water ice rocks, these are in centimeters. This is a 3-centimeter rock, 4-centimeter rock, 15-centimeter rock. So that gives you an idea of the scale, but they look like they're rounded. They look like they may have been eroded by liquid, so it's it kind of flips your brain on its head. Flip your brain on its head. That should be an expression. Make sure you use that. It flips your brain on its head and creates a concept where the water is acting like rocks and another liquid is acting like a liquid. But first, let me show you a super secret photograph that was taken by one other photograph by Huygens shortly after landing. Next image. And that's right, the alien penguins stole the Huygens probe and went off with it. Okay, no, it didn't actually. This was also from our art contest as well. Art by Bryce Jacobs. Who was the previous art by? Stephen Hobbs was the previous art we had. So, we start. So, on Titan, to overstate what's probably obvious, it's really, really cold. You're very, very far from the sun. You have lots of ices. You have water being completely solid ice. But what you do have is methane and ethane and other anes that form hydrocarbons. Hydrocarbons being hydrogen combined with carbon molecules, things we think of in more complicated forms, things like soot on Earth. But one moment, please. I have some hydrocarbon in my throat. Nasty anes. So on Earth, methane and ethane, which are the major constituents of the atmosphere, nitrogen's the major constituents of the atmosphere, but to skip ahead in our story, methane and ethane seem to be what form the liquid on Titan. Methane and ethane on Earth is natural gas. So the same stuff you're burning in stoves and heaters, such like that, that is what the lakes, what the rivers, what the rainfall on Titan is liquid methane and ethane, simple hydrocarbons, simple chains of hydrocarbons, intriguing and different. Now, astrobiologists are kind of excited about Titan, not for the concept that you'd have life there now, probably, but because it represents kind of an early Earth playground pretend structure. It's a prebiotic Earth with one really important difference, too. Temperature, lack of liquid water. But having hydrocarbons around, it's that kind of stuff that we think life evolved from and moves along with. But let's look at... Let me cough some more anes up, and let's look at some pictures. Let's look at some radar. So let's look at the next image full screen, show you something. Put your radar brain on. Think back to Venus radar imaging. Here we have an impact crater. So those are there, but they're not very common. So what does that tell us? Tells us it's a fairly young surface geologically, because we actually have erosion going on there, liquid erosion in some places. Next image. So here we see some flow. Now this could be more volcanic or liquid, but some type of flow contact. So these kind of images look like something you might find on Venus. Let's look at the next image, something you won't see on Venus. This is a near-infrared image. So it's seeing through the atmosphere, and it is seeing a specular reflection of sunlight off a lake. So just like when the sun is on the other side of a lake and you see, or the ocean, you see all that bright reflection right back into your eyes, that's what we're seeing here is the glint of sunlight off a lake. And it was one of the early indications that, yes, there is indeed liquid there. But then we've gotten lots more indication. Let's look at the next image, and this takes almost 10 years of radar mapping from the various flybys. Gives us a look at the North Polar region. So the North Pole of Titan is somewhere around here. And they've color-coded this as people will have want to do. So remember, this is radar data. The color is false, but it's coded to some real things. So they've made very radar smooth areas look black to black bluish like lakes. And in fact, we think all of these big blue areas and all these little blue areas are in fact active current liquid methane ethane lakes on Titan. So kind of a big, huge, hairy deal. Why? What makes it interesting? And give you a random space fact. Titan's the only other place in the solar system that has liquid stable on its surface. No other place other than Earth. Earth, liquid water, Titan, liquid methane and ethane, period. There has been liquid on different bodies in the solar system at the surface, but not now. So that's what's going on. Let me look at a question. Christopher Kane, is it likely that there are any permanent lakes on Titan, or do they appear and disappear periodically? They do appear and disappear, but probably on many years to tens of years, so short geologically speaking. Time frames, there's a change with seasons, and so when you get different temperatures due to the different seasons that you get over many, many years with Saturn, you actually do get variability in these lakes, although I think many of the, especially the larger ones, are quite long-term, certainly on human time scales. Let us take a look at a short video. And I guess go ahead and leave my sound up for soaring over Titan lakes. Let's take a look at that video. So this is basically taking the data that we looked at in still form and put it in a video. So again, they refer to them as hydrocarbon seas. Kraken Mare, the largest Titan sea, 1,100 or so kilometers in length. So these are big things. So this is taking and creating artificial flyovers. And you can see they've got different lakes. The lakes on Titan, named after mythological sea creatures, like Kraken Lake. Most of the liquid, yes. So again, you see these effects of season and topography in terms of the hemispheres on Titan. Okay, so and you can see that also there is topography, there are hills and mountains, and small lakes tucked in. Lovely getaways, lakeside getaways. Of course, it's only, 100 kelvins, so bring your parka or more. Okay, let us, we will not play the next video because it's largely redundant with that one. And let's go to the next image. We'll take the next couple images, and then we will play the Cassini coming attractions at Saturn. Video number 3 will be the next video we play. So let's look at this full screen. This is just another take at part of this region. Again, color added artificial, although it is tied to radar properties that do make it look like all these things are indeed lakes. They're also a note. They think the lakes probably being this hydrocarbon soup are probably pretty darn dark, if not black, in the way they look. Now, next image, let's look at one of these internal model theories of the interior of Titan. And here the concept, you've got a multi-layer concept. So you've got the organics-rich, the carbon-rich, hydrocarbon-rich atmosphere and surface, but again, remember, mostly nitrogen atmosphere. Got water ice shell under that, so even though we see these methane and ethane lakes and such, still the major thing you've got going on is water ice. And then once again, it looks like we have a global, probably a liquid water ocean layer, but now not over rocky material, but over high pressure ice. Again, I've mentioned before, ice, when you put it under high pressure, has all sorts of phases that we as normal humans don't ever encounter. And so you can end up having ice over liquid over ice in type conditions. And then a hydrosilicate core, so water rich but with silicate rocks forming the majority probably of that moon. So we'll want to look for more exciting discoveries from Cassini over the next few years. This is going to be really groovy when they dive through the inside of the rings. They usually keep away from things like rings and close to planets when they're trying to keep their spacecraft going for long periods of time. But I guess with the fuel running out, mission winding down, they'll start getting wacky and zany. But in the meantime, you will undoubtedly keep seeing new discoveries and revelations about Titan, about Enceladus, about all sorts of stuff. Let's see with the Cassini mission. Go ahead and run the Cassini coming attractions with the sound up on that and my sound down. Thank you.
Cassini is there in the Saturn system now, has been making discoveries for the last several years, and there's more to come. By studying the satellites in the Saturnian system, we begin to understand something also about the origin of the solar system.
There is strong evidence now that most of the surface of Titan is in fact covered with organic material of some kind.
We're going to be looking at lakes on the surface of this moon in detail. We're going to be looking at the atmosphere to see how the climate changes over time.
We have some global circulation models that tell us as the winds pick up, we think there could be waves on the lakes of liquid methane.
Can you imagine anybody thinking that we would discover active cryovolcanism on one of these moons? Geysers? One of the things that we'll do in the next couple of years is make the first ever flyby through the plume when the plume output is at its maximum.
And then, of course, there's the planet Saturn itself. As we go through our series of orbits and as the seasons change, it's like having a brand new mission.
One Saturn year is nearly 30 Earth years. To be there for nearly half of a Saturn year is a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity.
The sun now is coming up on the North Pole, so we're getting to see territory that was in darkness when we first arrived in 2004. Pretty soon we'll have the whole hexagon and the hurricane inside of it illuminated by the sun. And then, of course, the mission's end itself is completely unique.
Starting in 2016, ending in 2017, these orbits will take us up and over the north and south poles of the planet.
We're actually going to dive in between the innermost edge of the D-ring and the upper atmosphere of the planet itself.
From that, we're going to learn how is Saturn constructed from inside out.
We'll also get the magnetic field of the planet, the mass of the rings for the very first time, and get to sample a place that no spacecraft has ever flown before.
This is a mission that cannot be duplicated. So we really want to take advantage of this opportunity to observe seasonal variation in the system.
Northern summer is coming. Be there.
All right, it is time to move on to a new planet system. It's time to move on to Uranus, and I wore my Uranus and Neptune tie, so we got little blue spherical nodules. That's important to point out, of course. No, it's actually not. So Uranus, farther out, let's take a little background on Uranus. First of all, we're getting farther out in the solar system. Well, first of all, let's just address up front. Let's take the 1 minute to address the adolescent humor. Uranus, of course, the butt of many jokes. And I will give you the embarrassing random space fact about Uranus that I proudly or not so proudly actually derived myself. If the sun, this is a scale model solar system, sun's at the top of your head, no scale size, just distance. Pluto, bottom of your feet. Uranus is right where you'd expect it to be. Okay, that now ends our adolescent look at Uranus, but it does give you an idea that you probably will never be able to burn from your brain of the scale of Uranus within the solar system between the Sun and Pluto. We now move on to Sirius Uranus. Uranus has an 84-year year. That means it has 21-year seasons. Now, what's weird about Uranus, well, there are a lot of weird things about Uranus, but one of the weirdest and that makes it stand out in our solar system is its axial tilt. So whereas things like Jupiter, Mercury, they pretty much orbit, look, planet, sun, rotation, around pen is the rotation axis. Many of the planets orbit like this, and so if they orbit truly with the axis straight up and down, they essentially have no seasons. Earth, 23.5 degrees tilt. That's exactly 23.5 degrees. Well, maybe not. Orbits around, that's what causes our seasons as the different hemispheres point towards the sun. Now, Uranus tipped almost completely on its side, so there are times of year where, for example, the northern hemisphere will be facing directly at the sun, and the southern hemisphere will not get any sunlight for years, 21 year seasons. And then it reverses on the other side, and then in between you got the equinox, where you got it rotating around and everything's getting sunlight. So in terms of atmospheric dynamics driven by sunlight, you get a lot of variations as you go through these different time periods, and we've actually watched a fair amount of that. I should take 2 seconds to summarize the spacecraft exploration of Uranus and Neptune. Voyager 2, we're done. That is the spacecraft exploration. So all spacecraft pictures you'll be seeing are from Voyager 2, which had a Uranus encounter in 1986, Neptune encounter in 1989. The equinox for Uranus was in 2007, so we'll see variability as we look at lots of pictures. Let's start looking at pictures. Let's look at the first image full screen. And on the left side, you will see what Voyager 2 saw when it got to Uranus. That's right, a blue ball. Reminds you of our orange ball at Titan. Nothing. No cloud patterns. Nothing. Invisible wavelengths. So in an act of desperation, they did some image processing and tried to make it look more interesting by applying false color. But I digress. Let's go to the next image. We'll come back to Uranus getting more intriguing. First, let's establish where it is. We've got Sun, Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus. Notice these leaps are happening more and more. So we've got Uranus at 19.2 AU from the Sun. So that means say it were 20 AU, then 1 over 20 squared, 1 over 400 is how much less sunlight Uranus and the Uranian system gets than Earth does. It falls off, as I mentioned, as R squared, the sunlight. So cold, really, really cold, really not very much light compared to Earth. Nice Uranus orbit. Here's Neptune. Next image. Scale reminder, inner solar system, Sun, Jupiter, Saturn, and here's our friend Uranus, the blue ball, and Neptune. Neptune and Uranus, similar in size. Next image. Now here's another scale, as opposed to the really out of control comparison between the Earth and places like Jupiter, or worse yet, the Sun. At least we're kind of in the ballpark, so this would be Earth compared to the size of Uranus. Still a giant planet, still a lot bigger than we are. So don't pick fights with it. What's inside Uranus? Let's look at the next image. So, remember Jupiter and Saturn had lots of hydrogen, some helium, and then they created this weird metallic hydrogen inside. Well, Uranus and Neptune, not big enough to get the metallic hydrogen, but do have, again, mostly hydrogen, a lot of helium. But the bluish color comes from methane in large quantities, will give a bluish hue, or large volumes. Still mostly hydrogen and helium, but there's a lot more of methane going on out here. And then in the mantle down deeper, probably other weird and not weird things like water and ammonia, methane, and in ice forms. And then down deep, a smallish, smaller than Earth, Earth for scale is here, rocky core. Okay, back to pictures of Uranus. Let's look at the next image. So this is another desperate attempt to make the Uranus atmosphere look interesting and beautiful from Voyager 2. And in fact, they made it look quite pretty by looking at it after Voyager 2 had passed the planet, looking back and just catching the limb in sunlight. But alas, Uranus, when we look in other wavelengths, when we look over the years, as the seasons have changed to Uranus, we start seeing all sorts of cloud activity. Let's go ahead and run the video with my sound up and look at the Uranian system, which does consist of moons, who we'll talk about just a little bit, although no big moons, big giant moons at Uranus. So this is Hubble, seems fuzzier than it should be, but Hubble Space Telescope imagery, you can see rings. There are indeed rings around Uranus. Those blobs are moons orbiting around, shown at a larger scale than they actually would be. And this is in the 90s, with the northern hemisphere just starting to come around and get sun. The southern hemisphere is what we're seeing on the left. We see a polar hood of clouds. And notice we're seeing cloud features going around, and that's both there's more going on in the atmosphere and also mixing in some near-infrared wavelengths. They're speeding things up. They're getting crazy. So this is not in real time, obviously. This is showing many years of data over time. But notice the rings start turning more edge on to the Earth. Well, the Earth is so far away and towards the inner solar system, we're practically at the sun, as seen by Uranus. And so we're actually watching the ring system where it was. We were looking at it from above, essentially, or below, depending on how you look at it. Well, as the years have passed and it moved towards equinox, which this is, and these data are from the 90s before equinox, the rings actually became more and more edge on, and then at equinox it became completely edge on. So this is showing some wind models and such, and you're starting to see some of the northern hemisphere and some of the cloud systems there. There's also some simulations of ring particle movement here, not actual, that have been added to the actual data. So just a view of our friend, the Uranian system. Okay, let us look at the next image, which is basically taken from that type of Hubble Space Telescope imagery. And here you can see just where each of these blips is showing a moon. We've got rings, and we'll talk about the rings in a moment. This is the polar hood I was referring to over the South Pole. And then this is the northern region of the atmosphere, which, remember, sat for like 20 years in cold darkness, now getting sunlight, probably starting to drive atmospheric circulation, storms, cloud formation, etc. Next image, another look at Uranus, but now in 2004, a couple different views, and again you see kind of this polar hood, but you're seeing more and more of the northern hemisphere. You're seeing these clouds in various bands and belts. Again, ring system where you've got kind of a dominant brighter ring and then some less bright rings. And this, I believe, again, is near-infrared or a mix of near-infrared and visible. Next image shows some data from 2004 from Keck Observatory in Hawaii. And so here, look at the ones on the right. These are 2.2 microns, so near-infrared, somewhat shorter near-infrared, 1.6 microns zoomed in down here. So we've been able now with better and better ground-based telescopes to actually watch cloud features on Uranus that we see now that exist, particularly looking in the infrared. What are we seeing between these two images? Well, on the left is just what you see with your average run-of-the-mill 10-meter telescope. Okay, there is no average run-of-the-mill 10-meter telescope, but that's what you see without adaptive optics. This is what you see with adaptive optics turned on, obviously much, much better. And it's adaptive optics and other improvements in ground-based telescopes that have really revolutionized things like tracking atmospheric patterns and circulation in the giant planets, the way-out giant planets, and all sorts of other things. Adaptive optics, as I mentioned before, is basically where you have part of your telescope, you adjust, you manipulate to adjust for the turbulence in the atmosphere. So usually they shoot a laser into the sky, they track with that laser what should be a dot, what it ends up looking like, and know that it's changing because of turbulence in the atmosphere, refractive changes in the properties of the atmosphere, and they then give commands to usually the secondary mirror on the telescope to deform, to adapt to that. And that adaptive optics, again, has revolutionized the ability for ground-based telescopes it's they're still not working like a space-based telescope. The atmosphere is still causing problems, but you're able to subtract out a portion of the atmospheric problems. And as opposed to a space telescope, you can build a much bigger telescope on Earth. Your problem is that pesky atmosphere in the way. Ironically, when you're studying atmospheres like Uranus. Okay, now what else can you do to study Uranus? Lest we forget, there are whole other wavelength bands that can be accessed, including from the surface of the Earth. Let's look at the next image, full screen. This is radio images of Uranus. Well, actually, this is optical or near-infrared from Keck telescopes. And then this is the Very Large Array in New Mexico. This is radar data. And what radar, and then obviously false color applied, but you can see you've got some type of differences across the planet. You can use that radar data, the radio, I'm sorry, not radar, radio, passive, receiving radio data to model at things like atmospheric circulation. So you can use Doppler shift in the radio that you're seeing winds. You can measure wind speeds. You also, with radio, as you'll recall, it's going to penetrate deeper into the atmosphere. So you can use visible and infrared to look higher up in the atmosphere, and then use different wavelengths of radio to look at different depths in the atmosphere. When you do that, and you hand all that data to an atmospheric dynamicist, they can plug it in and start coming up with what's going on underneath what we're seeing, and what's driving the atmospheric circulation and how it's working on Uranus. So again, another lesson that I like to repeat endlessly of how working together between different wavelengths and using different parts of the electromagnetic spectrum can give you different insights, whether you're looking at a solid body or a planetary atmosphere. Okay, question. From John Olay, is the Hubble Space Telescope the only space-based telescope in existence, or are there others? There are others. Hubble has the best PR agent, and Hubble gets the closest to visible, although they do a lot of near-infrared work now, and it is by far the dominant space telescope for optical visible near-infrared. But you've also got Spitzer Space Telescope that works in the infrared. We talked to Amy Meinzer earlier in the course. She works with WISE data and NEOWISE. That is an infrared space telescope, but much, much smaller. And then you've got, we've had X-ray and gamma ray telescopes, smaller telescopes like on the Kepler Planet Finder. So there are actually a lot of number, I won't say a lot, but several space telescopes of varying size with varying purposes that are currently in orbit, more being built, including the monstrous James Webb Space Telescope for launch in a few years that will look at near-infrared and will be kind of the Hubble replacement. But it's different capabilities, but with even much larger collecting area. Okay, good. Okay, a couple more Uranus things, and then we'll move on to Uranian moons. So let's look at the next image. Full screen. So Uranus, trying to compete with Neptune, as we'll see in a moment with Neptune, fired up its own dark spot, and this is a blow-up. So also as dark spots, storms. Now this is not great red spot, two or three Earth size of Jupiter. This is an 8,000 kilometer bar, but still big, you know, good chunk of Earth represented by this, bigger than any Earth storm, certainly. Next image, let's talk a little bit about the Uranian magnetic field, and we talked some about magnetic fields a couple lectures ago. Uranus magnetic field, kind of funky. So Uranus, here it is, basically kind of tipped almost on its side, so to speak. So this is its rotation axis, what it's rotating around. This is the direction to the sun at the time this graph was made for. But what's strange about Uranus is that the magnetic field axis is actually significantly off of north. Now that's true for Earth as well. Our magnetic north pole is not the same as our geographic north pole, but it's similar. Whereas here it's a 59 degree difference. It's a big difference. Not only that, but the center of the magnetic field is actually off center from the center of the planet by a non-trivial amount. So a lot for magnetic field people to ponder and wonder about what's going on. Let's look at a video showing basically this magnetic field, the rotation going on. So this was an interesting find from Voyager. Let's go ahead and run that video. So again, note the line going almost horizontal is the rotation axis, which is perpendicular to the ring plane, as usual, whereas the purple thing showing the magnetic field rotating around with the planet. Those are the invisible used to help us understand the magnetic field lines. So it's basically still looking like a bar magnet magnetic field, what's called a dipole magnetic field, but it's askew. It's off. But all the giant planets whipping out magnetic fields of one kind, one strength or another. Okay. So, Uranian moons. There are indeed Uranian moons. Let's go ahead and let's look at a couple pictures and then talk about it and use that to talk about them. Let's look at the first image, just to set the stage. Go ahead and full screen. So we looked at this before, little blips, those are moons. Next image, let's go back to our reference diagram we keep going back to of moons in the solar system that are all scaled to each other under Earth. So Earth's size here. Notice with Jupiter, we got four really big moons. Saturn, we got one ginormous, similarly big moon. At Uranus, there is no one big moon, but there are lots of good-sized moons, especially four or five of them that are a few hundred to many hundreds of kilometers in diameter, at least. So they're there. They're interesting. Let's look at the five biggest ones in the next image. So we've got Miranda, Ariel, Umbriel, and Oberon. And we'll look at them in more detail, but they're basically rocky, icy moon bodies. Here is your certificate, random space fact, for the day. So if you're not enrolled to course, but want your certificate of accomplishment at the end, here is the certificate random space fact for this lecture that you will input on a quiz at planetary.org after the course is all over. Uranian moons are named after characters from Shakespearean plays and then a couple of strays from plays by other authors, including Alexander Pope. So that's why you may recognize some of the names as from being from Shakespeare plays. Different than most of the other places in the solar system where moons are usually named after Greek or Roman mythology and things that are related to the planet in that mythology. All right, let's look at some pictures of Uranian moons. Next image. Full screen. So we've got, again, a concept of how far out they are. This is a infrared image from, I believe it's infrared, from the Very Large Telescope in, literally called the Very Large Telescope in Chile. We've got Uranus, we got rings, and we've got some of the bigger moons, Titania, not surprisingly, being the biggest. Umbriel, Ariel, Oberon, Puck, and Portia, some smaller ones, and Miranda. Next image, let's go one through some of them. Miranda, one of the weirder looking moons, because not only do you have kind of normal, so to speak, looking moon terrain, heavily cratered, but you also have this weird, fractured, crushed together area stuff going on. Next image, we'll zoom in on some of that. So here you can see areas up close where you actually have different terrains meeting together. You got really severe geology going on. You do have craters, you know, small craters and larger craters on top of things, but a very fractured, messed up surface. That's probably not what geologists would call it usually, but we'll call it a messed up surface. Next image. We've got these so-called chevron terrains, because they look like, well, chevrons, where you seem to have these terrains with the fractures and grabens and stuff coming together with a smoother, heavily cratered thing. Still a little mysterious exactly what formed this. A couple competing theories. One is just an internally driven, some type of convection, tectonics, or an actual partial breaking apart of the moon where it kind of reformed itself. Still competing again. This is the only close-up data we've got is from Voyager 2. Next image. This is Ariel. Again, cratered, icy, rocky body, but now we got some big grobbins going on, tectonically pulled apart areas. Next image. This is Umbriel. Umbriel looking pretty straightforward at these resolutions anyway, being a really heavily cratered old surface. Next image, Titania. Titania got your heavily cratered stuff, but also got some really big fractures over here, possibly a big crater over on this side. Next image, Oberon. Oberon's, again, same kind of things going on. Heavily cratered, some looks like craters pulling up lighter materials from underneath dark materials. But there's only so far we can go because these are pretty much the best images we've got of these moons is from Voyager 2 in 1986. Move on to the Uranian moons. Let's look at the next image. Rings. These are the rings from behind. Now remember what an incredible technological achievement this is. Voyager 2 launched in 1977, so early 70s at best technologies. Designed really for Jupiter and Saturn, but they adapted on en route to try to be able to do Uranus as well and Neptune in much darker areas. And that included pointing, turning the spacecraft camera system so that in this case you followed the ring system and tracked those as the spacecraft was flying by. All these little streaks, those are stars. Stars that are not moving, but the spacecraft is moving. And so they kept the spacecraft focused on the near field rings and gave us, you know, great data about the rings. And notice, again, like at Saturn, when we got there, we thought there were a few rings. Now, well, gosh, there's lots and lots and lots and lots and lots of rings. Not the volume, not the size of the Saturnian rings, but a lot, still quite a lot going on. Next image. And here we've got rings against Uranus. So I think they're not shadows. We're actually seeing some of the, it has a lot of these very thin rings. Next image, better image, give you a feel for the rings. So a brighter individual and then some other individual rings going on here. Next image. Now here we talked about Shepard moons at Saturn. Well, you also see Shepherding moons in the Uranian rings. Part of what's keeping this ring so nice and tight, probably constrained, is these two little moons inside these circles, one on each side, pushing, pulling, tugging, keeping things in place. Next image. And after I finish through these images, I'll take some questions. So here we have a Uranian ring diagram as well as moons. It's a little confusing because they've shown orbits of moons. They kind of look like rings, but they're just the orbit. So this is Miranda. As usual, as happens, you don't get any big moons in where you got the rings. You can keep small moons, but you can't keep a big object without differential gravity ripping it apart if you get too far in. So by the time we get to one of the larger moons, Miranda, we're out beyond the edge of the rings. And then next image, we've got from the European Southern Observatory, the Uranian rings edge on. So this had to be about 2007, first of all. So we're looking at that equinox period I talked about. So now we're looking at the equatorial plane, the equator of Uranus is like this. And we're also seeing the moons, which are in the equatorial plane, edge on. And then this is the same image on the right, but they've taken this part and they've contrast stretched it to brighten it up. And you can actually see the rings that are now edge on because it's the equinox and we're basically essentially where the sun is relative to Uranus. So we're seeing the system edge on now at that period of time. Okay, some questions. From Alexander Ortiz, why are there storms on Uranus? It is a gas planet. Is there wind on this planet? Yeah, there's a lot of wind. There's hundreds of kilometers per hour winds. It is driven, the storms are driven for similar reasons to on Earth, although there's other stuff with liquid water going on Earth, but you've got, you have sun heat energy from the sun. You also have internal heat from the center of the planet, from original formation, from radioactive materials. That's putting energy into the system. You also have various things that go back and forth between being ice or even liquid and gas, and that's moving energy into different parts of the planet. You also have the rotation of the planet. All of that muddles together in one big complicated dynamics problem that generates storms and winds. From Burgundy, how long has the Hubble Space Station been up there? Did it outlast its originally estimated orbit? Certainly outlasted its originally estimated lifetime by a lot. It went up in 1990, I believe. So I think we're on 24 years of Hubble Space Telescope. Now, as opposed to any planetary spacecraft, Hubble actually was designed to be serviced by astronauts and was serviced, I believe, 5 times by shuttle astronauts. So got some replacement parts to keep it working longer. Also, new science instruments. That was a nice side benefit, not just replacing things that were broken, but also putting in new, different, and or more advanced science instruments. From Katie Gilliam, is anybody else currently working on exploration of Uranus? If so, how long in the future would it be? People are working on it, but there's nothing planned. It actually was, every 10 years, there's a decadal study done by the National Research Council, and they identify important things in planetary to try to do. And they put Uranus as on the list, the Uranian system, that would be good to send a big mission. But it would be very expensive, complicated, get it out there. They actually are looking at a Uranus orbiter. To my knowledge, there's no real movement on that in a political or budget way. I don't think any other agency on Earth is actively, at least there's nothing in production. So it's going to be many, many years, possibly decades, before we get something back out to Uranus. Okay, let us go on. Let's go on to Neptune. Neptune, kind of the sister planet of Uranus, so to speak, both big blue balls looking that are similar in size. Neptune, again, much farther out, though. In fact, let's go ahead and, I'll take this one last Uranus question while I'm still leaving Uranus. From Christopher Kane, how many total moons does Uranus have? We don't know. How many have we found? It's something in the around 15. I'm not exactly sure, but it's approximately 15. Again, finding more just like we are with the other planets, but perhaps not as quickly. So it seems to not have as many, but it as to say Jupiter and Saturn, probably doesn't because of the size. But on the other hand, it's a sampling effect. It's much farther away, so it's much harder to find things, especially when you don't have spacecraft going there all the time. Okay, Neptune. Let's put up a picture full screen. So this was Neptune from Voyager 2, 1989. Great dark spot. Scooter, the little storm nicknamed Scooter. So you see cloud features. You see the blue again from methane. But again, very similar in general description to Uranus in terms of the atmosphere, hydrogen, helium. We'll come to that in a moment. Let's look at the next image. Talk distance. So now we're at 30 AU with Neptune as opposed to 19 AU with Uranus. Jupiter, for reference, is about 5 AU, so you can think it's like Jupiter-Sun distances. It's another 2 Jupiter-Sun distances to go from Uranus's orbit to Neptune. So it is a non-trivial additional distance out in the solar system. It is 30 AU. It receives, therefore, about 1/900th the sunlight that the Earth receives, 1 over 30 squared. So cold. Not much light, not much energy coming from the outside. Next image. Uranus, Neptune. Here's our friend Neptune. Next image. I just view that we make friends with all planets as we visit them. Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, there we go. Neptune, so Neptune again, very similar thinking in terms of the internal composition, but again, we have very little information. We have Voyager flybys. Usually it's flybys that give us internal information by studying the gravitational pull on the spacecraft, and we don't have much of that. So there's a lot of guesswork and a lot of computer modeling going on to get at these. So they're probably basically right, but the details could be rather different. Next image, going back to Neptune. So great dark spot. And this was so big storm system, very much like the Jupiter red spot, but not seemingly as long lived. Higher clouds as well. This spot they nicknamed Scooter because it moved around quickly in their imagery. Let me point out a couple other Neptune-Uranus contrasts. So because you're farther out, now you have a Uranus year is 84 Earth years long, 21 year seasons. A Neptune year is 165 Earth years long. So we've now, perhaps depressingly, reached a planet that takes longer than a human lifetime to go around the sun. Although hopefully we'll catch up with those human lifetimes soon. Please. Very similar in mass between the two, 17 versus 15. Jupiter for reference, 17 Earth masses versus 15 Earth masses. Jupiter for reference is 318. What's interesting, and more interesting about Neptune, I think we'll hear reference to this in one of the videos, is there are really high wind speeds on Neptune. There seems to be a lot of internal energy, and it's not totally well understood why there's so much driving stuff. Because again, you get very little sunlight energy compared to Earth. You're still getting a non-trivial amount of energy, but very little compared to Earth. But you actually have more energy coming from the interior than you do from the sun. I think a factor of 2 or 2.5 times more based upon what we're seeing on the outside and the temperatures driving things like atmospheric circulation. And that's some combination, again, of original formation, gravitational differentiation, releasing energy, and then radioactive sources and the like. But still, kind of surprising to people. Okay, let's look at more pictures. Next image, please, full screen. So here we've got two different times, Voyager data, great dark spots. You can see, like, especially in these upper clouds, you got some variation even on the time frames. Voyager 2, observe them. Next image, video. We'll run a video. Well, this is fine. Let me finish this image and then we'll run that video. So this is a cool, groovy picture. You have the blue atmosphere below, but then some white, at least comparatively white, clouds, ice clouds up high over the Neptune atmosphere. Let's go ahead and run the short video about the weather on Neptune and the surprise that it was with the sound up on the video. Thank you.
A few clouds, and at least that was better than Uranus, but we really weren't prepared for the spectacular weather activity that Voyager found. In fact, Neptune is the windiest planet in the solar system, and I was totally unprepared for that. The winds are 325 meters per second. That's the speed that the great dark spot is moving relative to the inside of Neptune. Everything's going to the east, but the great dark spot is going more slowly to the east than the inside of Neptune.
As we keep finding out, when you go explore places, you get surprised. You learn stuff. It's cool. Let's look at more pictures. Okay, back to pictures now, Earth telescope. So now we're going to see the same thing that we did like with Uranus. Once you get to bigger telescopes on Earth, more adaptive optics as well as Hubble, we're able to monitor these planets that when Voyager 2 went there, we just had fuzzy views of them. Now, between Hubble and adaptive optics Earth-based, we can actually track cloud systems and track atmospheric changes at some level from telescopes. Let's look at the next image, full screen. Okay, so these are actually Hubble telescope images from 1996, 98, and 2002. Probably near infrared wavelengths with some false color, and you can see some variation in cloud features. Of course, there are probably variations happening even on a faster time frames as well. But this gives you an idea of what we can monitor even 10 years ago from Earth, from Hubble, and continue to be able to monitor these giant planets in ways that we just couldn't do back when Voyager flew by. Next image, rings. Oh, go ahead and erase that. So these, we've got some discrete rings in Neptune. Notice this kind of, this clumpiness, this thicker parts, brighter parts. That is actually real. They have, this is a Voyager image that they've stretched, contrast stretched tremendously, so you've completely washed out the planet over here so that you can actually see the ring system. So a very faint ring system. Another way to do that is in the next image where you just blacken out the where the planet is so you can see the ring. So again, a faint ring system. Interesting, because when they were first discovered from Earth, there was actually a question whether they were just ring arcs, just fragments of rings, because they couldn't see the rings from Earth at that time. They were looking at the rings blocking out starlight and occulting the starlight, and they would see it some places in the ring and not others. Well, it turns out it's that clumpiness. They are complete rings going around the planet, but they're actually thicker and chunkier in some parts than they are in other parts. Next image. So this is Voyager 2. This is what happens when you stretch, contrast stretch your data, brighten it more than it really wants to be done. And you do get data out of it, but you also create a tremendous amount, see all the cruddy noise going on in your data. Next image leads us on to our next topic. This is Neptune and Neptune's large, strange moon, Triton. So let us go on to Neptunian moons. The Neptune moons are dominated by Triton. It is significantly larger than, really it's just a bunch of very small moons and Triton. And we'll see how big Triton is in just a moment. But Triton, unusual beast right off the bat, because it orbits retrograde, meaning that if Neptune's rotating around this way, Triton is orbiting around this way, and it's a little bit out of the plane. That's not how most moons form. Most moons, particularly in close to the planet, like Triton, relatively close, are going to orbit prograde. That's the opposite of retrograde, orbiting the same way the planet is rotating. Because they form in system at the same time. It's just like all the planets revolve around the sun in the same direction. Well, moons tend to revolve around the planet because you're all forming in a spinning system. So when you see a moon retrograde, you get suspicious. And to skip ahead to the punchline, we think Triton's probably a captured object. It is not easy to capture a moon, but you can do it. If you are a planet, by having the moon come in at just the right angles, or even skim some outer stuff. Anyway, it's tricky, but it can be done. But it especially if you come in and you end up in a retrograde orbit like this, it actually limits the long-term geologic timescale lifetime of the moon. So Triton's intriguing because now there's more and more thought, I think, that the Triton is representative of what some of the types of bodies we're going to talk about next week, trans-Neptunian objects, objects out beyond Neptune, things like Pluto, things like Eris. And then maybe by seeing Triton, we've kind of sampled one of those in a captured in the Neptune Zoo as opposed to in the wild. Anyway, there's a little introduction to Triton. Let's look at a picture of Triton. Let's go ahead and look at this full screen. I remember distinctly in 1989, actually at a Planetary Society event, Planetary Society Planet Fest, where they were showing images coming down from Voyager 2. And I was, you know, studying planets by that time, and then these images came in, and it just made me, and I think the science team, feel really ignorant. Because suddenly you were seeing stuff that just didn't look like any other place we'd seen in the solar system. We'll look at all of this in more detail, but you have two radically different terrains. This stuff called cantaloupe terrain, because it looks like the surface of a cantaloupe. And then this stuff down here, which has no official name, I will call it Herman. I will call it pizza terrain for right now. And so we got this really different looking stuff. Okay, back to size. Let's look at the next image. Triton orientation. So this is the size of Triton compared to, say, Titan, your Galilean satellites, Moon, Earth. So it's a big guy. Not as big as most of those big ones I just pointed out, but it's a big hunk of Moon. But nothing else much in the system. You got Nereid is the next biggest thing, and it's that big. So, and this is much larger than like Pluto's moon, Charon. Next image. Oh, I'm sorry. No. Let us look at the video. Sorry. Let's go ahead and run video. Seem to be video and image impaired today of keeping track. So run a video of Hubble showing Neptune and its moons from 2005. So again, wonderful thing about having Hubble, having big fancy Earth telescopes now, is you can actually do stuff. Now they've applied false color, we're looking in near infrared, but we're seeing cloud features, we're seeing the big bright dot is Triton, the little dots are the other moons. But you can see different cloud systems, polar hoods. Neptune, I should be explicit, Neptune, although tilted, does not have that flipped on its side like Uranus, so you also don't have that going on. You don't have whole hemispheres of Neptune that don't get sunlight for long periods of time, but you do have seasonal effects like we have seasonal effects on Earth. Okay, now this image full screen, this image, whatever image you've got up there, we'll go with that. Okay, so again, another look at Triton. We'll just look at a few of these with the large albedo, brightness, contrast, light, dark regions. Really, another video? I've done this to myself again? Okay, fine. Notice in this image, there's some dark streaks, and look for them later on. There are various dark streaks that show up even better in other images. Oh, I know, I'm sorry, next image. Boy, I am just confused today. There we go. In this image, particularly over here, you can see some dark streaks. Well, that's weird. Those look like wind streaks. Well, Triton does have an atmosphere. It is a very, very thin atmosphere. Its primary constituent is nitrogen. So now we have three bodies in the solar system that are mostly nitrogen in their atmospheres, Earth, Titan, and Triton, although Triton's atmosphere is a tiny fraction of the amount of atmosphere that we have, but we seem to have wind effects. And then there was another one of those shocking discoveries. Run the video. Triton has geysers. We saw geysers from Voyager 2, surprised the heck out of people, because you're sitting there at 50 to 150 kelvins. It is cold. So this is just it's a little video from three images repeated over and over again. You see this dark geyser going up and winds blowing it downstream. And that's seems to be what causes these wind streaks. Geysers of dark stuff that then gets deposited. And this was surprising. It seems to be, the theories seem to revolve around having it multiple layers of ice. And these are, again, we have water ice, but we also have exotic ices going on here. Exotic from an Earth perspective. We have methane ice, we've talked about that before, but now it's so cold, we actually are freezing nitrogen out. We get the conditions that allow you to have frozen nitrogen. And the nitrogen ice and the methane ice form layers, and you end up with darker ice under lighter ice, and then the sunlight, what there is of it, will get preferentially heat up that lower layer because it's darker. And eventually, when that turns from a solid to a gas, because that causes a huge expansion in volume, that forces a break in the overlying ice and creates a geyser. And then if there's wind, it transports that now refreezing icy material. Okay, so weird place. More big surprises. Next image. Full screen, Now you can really see why it's called cantaloupe terrain. Based upon the morphology, this seems to be, again, weird ices, weird features. Notice very few impact craters, maybe something hiding down here, maybe a few mixed in here, but at smaller scales, it looks like there's probably one over here. So not super fresh, but geologically relatively young. Next image. So there seem to be, on these very long Triton seasons, which would follow the Neptune seasons, which are like 40 years in length, more than 41 years, we seem to have variations in what's going on the surface of the atmosphere. Here's another image, just give you an idea of the terrain. Let's go to the next image. It's a little better. And here's a weird thing. Not quite circular, does not seem to be an impact feature. So you got some interesting features going on in the ice. There is a nice impact feature there, but again, not a lot of them, and some kind of weird ice features. So very intriguing, and again, our only snapshot is from Voyager 2. Fortunately, they focused on Triton, so we got, because it was the big thing in the system, so we got a lot of imagery that's quite intriguing. Next image. And here we see Pizza Land, but you can see the dark streaks here from what are probably from geysers, which fortunately we happened to catch one, and this seems to be a boundary region. I think we're getting into the cantaloupe terrain over here. It's kind of a stretched color to it. Oh, well, it's probably somewhat similar to what your eye would see, but it is enhanced, so this is a false color. Next image. And this one is, again, similar area on the, but showing more of the boundary with between the cantaloupe terrain and what I've called pizza terrain. Cantaloupe, an official term, pizza terrain, I just made it up. Next image, lots of pizza, more cantaloupe. We're seeing the same region, but now we're seeing more of this, and again, lots and lots of these dark streaks, all pretty much in the same way, so you can get an idea of wind patterns, wind direction. Next image. Here we have just more weird features. People are still trying to figure out. We got some nice straightforward impact craters there, but then we got some interesting light dark stuff going on here. So there seems to be a transport on a seasonal basis from one hemisphere to the other hemisphere. On Triton, we have a situation, we have nitrogen, which as I said, is like Titan and Earth. But neither Titan or Earth are cold enough to freeze out the nitrogen. So we have a situation kind of like on Mars, where you have the dominant atmospheric constituent. For Mars, it's carbon dioxide. For Triton, it is nitrogen. But both places, what makes the atmosphere particularly kind of intriguing, you freeze out the main constituent. So you change the atmospheric pressure drastically as you freeze and sublimate the nitrogen that's on the surface. And in fact, there seems to be, as there is at Mars, there seems to be some polar shifting as you go from winter to summer, and you sublimate the stuff off in the summer hemisphere and you move it to the winter hemisphere and vice versa, and that may be part of what drives some of the unusual terrain type things and the hemispheric dichotomy that we see. Atmosphere, there is a little of it. Let's look at the next image full screen. Show you a crude basic image processing that can be effective. Here you've got a contrast stretch that focuses on the surface. Down here you've completely saturated just by changing the contrast, but now you can really see the atmosphere, including what might be a detached haze under that block right in there. Now let's go ahead and move to another moon. You know, the only other moon, well, yeah, we just don't have much in the way of other moon images. Next image is Proteus. So you got your basic oblong, smaller, rocky, icy body that we can't really see very well. And that is Proteus. So that's our tour of Neptune. Now, let's see, how much time we got? We've got 3.5 minutes. Let's go ahead and run the preview of next class, assuming people agree that I've got time to do that. And then I'll finish up in a minute. So if you want to go ahead and run the visit to Pluto, And next time we'll talk about Pluto and Neptunian objects. And if control room doesn't think I have time, just tell me and I'll blather for a couple of minutes. Next, you can start running the video whenever you want.
Paying a visit to Pluto, presented by Science at NASA. At this very moment, one of the fastest spacecraft ever launched, NASA's New Horizons, is hurtling through the void at nearly 1 million miles per day. Launched in 2006, it has been in flight longer than some missions last, and still has 4 more years of travel to go. New Horizons is headed for the lonely world of Pluto on the outer edge of the solar system. Although astronomers now call Pluto a dwarf planet, it's actually a large place, about 5,000 miles around at the equator, says Alan Stern, principal investigator for the mission. And it's never been explored. Indeed, no spacecraft has ever visited Pluto or any dwarf planet in the outer solar system. This is a whole new class of worlds, says Stern. To understand the solar system, we need to understand worlds like Pluto. Pluto is a resident of the Kuiper Belt, a vast region beyond the orbit of Neptune. Stern believes the Kuiper Belt contains 1,000 dwarf planets or more, a whole zoo of them. Dwarf planets are, in fact, the most numerous class of planets in the solar system, and probably in the whole universe. Pluto is a world of mysteries. For one thing, Stern wonders, what are the molasses-colored patches on Pluto's surface seen by the Hubble Space Telescope? Some scientists think that they could be deposits of primordial organic matter. New Horizons spectrometers will help us identify the kinds of organic molecules on Pluto. We expect to find something pretty interesting. Hubble recently contributed more intrigue by spotting a new moon circling Pluto, bringing the total to 4. Composite Hubble images of Pluto now resemble a miniature planetary system. New Horizons will hunt for even more moons as it approaches the dwarf planet.
So, that's your preview. Next week, we will not just be talking about Pluto and its system, but all of those objects out there past Neptune called trans-Neptunian objects, including the Kuiper Belt. We'll talk about comets. We'll talk about the cloud. The Kuiper Belt and the trans-Neptunian objects is a whole burgeoning field of discovery in planetary science. Lots of good-sized objects being discovered on a pretty regular basis, and so lots to talk about, but a lot of mystery still. New Horizons, by the way, that video was made two or three years ago, so New Horizons has close flyby of the Pluto system, July 2015. After a 9-year trip, we will finally get our first up-close look at Pluto and its friends. So come back next week. By the way, assignments are up on planetary.org/betsclass for those not enrolled. If you're curious what the class assignments were, you can go there. You can also find the archive of the video. I will see you next week. Take care. Thank you, and good night.